little while back, I did a couple of videos, one on the subject of covariance and one on contravariance. And the problem with those is that although they're quite important to understand as a C-sharp developer, they're not something for which there are very many good examples of when you'd need to implement them for yourself. They're really widely used in the built-in collection classes, particularly when you're using IEnumerable. And in fact, on those videos, all I did was rewriting essentially what the code was inside the .NET library so that you could see how it works. But it wasn't something you'd need to do for yourself. But then a project I was working on recently suddenly hit me was a situation where it would be useful for me to actually implement the idea of, in this case, covariance for myself within my own class hierarchy. And so I thought I'd just revisit that, so it's a nice example to get your head around for understanding covariance. So the application I was developing is actually something looking like this, which is basically where I've got this annotation tool. So basically we've got some kind of slideshow, something like that, and I can pick up these various tools and I could go for a blue polyline and start drawing on there, maybe to highlight something or something like that. Or I could go for a rectangle, so I could put a box around something there. Or indeed I could go for a highlighter, and so I could highlight a bit of text there. And in fact, what you've got there is simply the highlight is a rectangle just with different styling, so it's transparent and filled rather than having the outline. But that's what I've got. And what's actually happening with that in terms of the classes is that this is a WPF application, and WPF provides certain classes, all derived from a base class called Shape. So derived from that, we've got a polyline and we've got a rectangle and some other things as well. And so that's what I'm using to do the actual drawing in this application. But those classes don't do quite enough for me. And so what I've also added of my own code is a parallel class hierarchy where I've got a base class that I've called Sprite, and then derived from that, I've got a polyline sprite and a rectangle sprite. And as it develops, I'll have other ones as well, like text and that sort of thing. But what you can see is we've got these parallel hierarchies, one of shapes, one of sprites. And if we look back at what we had when we're talking about covariance, that's quite similar to the diagram we had then when we had the one hierarchy of fruit and apple and banana, and then the other hierarchy of the bag of fruit, the bag of apple, the bag of bananas, and whatever else you might have. And so as soon as you see this kind of parallel hierarchy, you're going to start thinking, is this a situation where we need to worry about covariance? And so if you haven't watched that earlier video on covariance, I really recommend that you do, because that's the basis that we're going to build this on. And of course, the other thing we're going to have on that diagram is ultimately we've got to have some kind of collection. So we're going to have what I'll call annotations, which is going to be a collection of these sprites, and then each sprite has the corresponding shape. And what we're basically asking ourselves is, just like we said, if an apple is a kind of fruit, can we also say a bag of apples is a kind of bag of fruit? What we're asking here is we're saying, if a polyline is a kind of shape, then is a polyline sprite also a kind of sprite? And so that's what we've got here. Now, the example of why I need to have these sprites in this case is to do highlighting. So there's lots of reasons why I need to add code to these sprites, but let's go for this simple one. And so what I could do is, if I draw on a polyline and then also draw on a rectangle, then I've got the ability with this tool to actually start selecting. That arrow's a bit big, this is still a work in progress, but basically if I drag that along, you can see that once it encompasses the polyline, then we've got that slight highlight on the polyline and similarly on the rectangle. So the way the selection is done is very simple. What happens is we simply look at this idea of the bounding box for, say, the polyline, and if the bounding box is entirely inside the selection box, then we count the polyline selected, and we also use that same bounding box to show the highlighting. Similarly, when we have the rectangle, once the bounding box is entirely inside the selection rectangle, then we highlight it. But the issue we have is that the way we calculate the bounding box is clearly going to be different for polylines and rectangles, and then for other things as we add them. Because for a rectangle, it's pretty simple, it's just the rectangle itself. But for a polyline, we've got to go through all the points, find the maximum and minimum of the X and Y, and that's what gives us our bounding box. So that's why we need to have these sprites to add that behavior onto what's happening basically in the shape. Now, the actual application I've got for you is not the full-blown one, because that would be very, very complicated to go through all the details. I've cut it down, so we've got this library where I have the sprite-based class And then we've got the derived polyline sprite and rectangle sprite. And then rather than doing any graphics at all, I've just got some xUnit unit tests to put it through its paces in terms of these bounding boxes and see how it works. So let's take a look at that. We've got our sprite-based class. So it's an abstract class called sprite, and it has this shape. And so remember, that shape is coming from system.windows.shapes. That's the WPF library we've got for that. And so it's got a shape and it's got a location. And then it's got this abstract property called bounding box, which is where in the derived classes we're going to do the different calculations depending on whether it's a rectangle or a polyline or whatever. And then the constructor simply takes the shape and the location and pops those into the appropriate properties. We've then also got this annotations, which is simply a collection of these sprites. So we've got a list of sprites. And then we've got a method on here where you pass in the selection box, and that then loops through all the sprites, has a look at the bounding box and compares it with the selection box. And if the bounding box is inside the selection box, then it gets included in the list that's returned. Then we've got our derived classes. So if we look at our polyline sprite, so derived from sprite has a constructor that takes a polyline. So that's again coming from this system.windows.shapes library, passes it down to the base class. But remember, the base class is only expecting a shape, but that's fine because a polyline is a kind of shape. And then we have the bit that's different, which is our bounding box. And so here, when we ask for a bounding box, we set up the initial values of top, bottom, left, and right, and then we loop through all of the points on the polyline, and basically we just use min and max of the current values and the x and y value for each point to build up overall this box, and then return a rect, which is the rectangle containing all that. Should point out slight confusion that there may be. We've got two library classes, one called rect, which is simply the geometric concept of a rectangle. So it's got a location and it's got a size. And then we've also got the WPF concept of the rectangle, which is the shape-derived class, which actually is the graphical element that you can see on the screen. So rect and rectangle, similar names, but doing different things. But now here we've got our rectangle sprite, and same sort of thing. It passes a rectangle down to the base class, and then its bounding box is much simpler because it's a rectangle. It already knows its own width and height. And then I've got the test code that makes all that work. So if we look in the selection tests, what I'm doing, I create a polyline with some values, I create a rectangle, and I create another polyline. And then I've got these tests where I've either got a selection box that I know is not going to get any of them, a selection box that's going to get all of them, and then more precisely, a selection box that is only going to get the rectangle. So if we just go back to the tool itself, what we've got here is effectively, I've gone for a polyline somewhere about there, and then we've got our rectangle, and then we've got another polyline. So it would look a bit like that if we displayed it. And then the three tests, I've either got that one, which is matching none of them, or I've got that one, which is matching all of them, or I've got that one, which is only going to match the rectangle. So that's what's happening with the test we've got there. And if we run those tests up, then we can see that's all working, but that's not really the problem we're addressing. One other little thing while we're here, which is really nothing to do with the main topic of covariance, but it's just something when you're doing unit testing on things in something like WPF, because you'll notice that rather than using the normal fact, I've used this thing called STA fact. And if I just left that as a fact and tried to run the tests, then you'll see we get an error on that one that I've done a fact for. And if we look at the error, it actually has the calling thread must be STA because many UI components require this. So STA stands for single threaded apartment. And what this is the fact that in something like WPF, you also find this in WinForms, there is a rule that visual elements can only be accessed from the thread that they were created in. And that's just to simplify the whole issue of multi-threading. And when you do xUnit normally, it doesn't enforce that rule. So we have this additional attribute called STAFact, which makes sure that the elements are called in the correct threaded way. That's not directly part of xUnit. If you want to get hold of that, you've got to have an additional package, which we've got in here, called xunit.stafact. So quite a nice little one that we can add on and works alongside xUnit and gives us that feature. So that's what we've got there. As I say, just an aside for that one, but a useful one to know. Now, however, let's actually look at the slight problem we've got in the code. So it works, but there's a thing in here that really I don't like, and that is this typecast. Because what we actually had to do inside our polyline binding box, and similarly in our rectangle one, we have to take the base class, this shape, which is of the base type shape, and cast it into a polyline so that I can get hold of the points. Because the problem is, although a polyline has a set of points, shapes in general don't have points. And so if I just treated it as a shape, we wouldn't get that. But whenever I see typecasting, particularly this, which is called downcasting, when we're going from the base class shape to the derived class polyline, I don't like it because it can lead to all sorts of problems. It's only a small thing, but you're going to have to do this in every one of the methods you have in your sprite. And as I say, there's more reasons to have it than just for the bounding box. And the problem is that although we know this is okay because we passed in a polyline down to the base class, therefore we know that it must be a polyline, so that typecast must work, it's not actually anything that can be enforced by the base class. So the sprite base class just knows it's dealing with a shape. And as I say, although we know it's working, if maybe we didn't have access to that sprite base class, how can we guarantee that what it's giving us as a shape is always going to be a polyline in this case, and is always going to be a rectangle in this case, and so on and so forth. So anytime you've got downcasting, it's not a nice thing to have. So can we fix that? Well, we can. What we do is this. We go back to our sprite, and we make our sprite generic. So we will have a generic parameter called T-shape, and then we'll put in a constraint that T-shape is going to have to be a shape. Okay, so that means that T-shape can be a shape or anything derived from a shape, so it can be a rectangle or a polyline or whatever the other ones are when we add them. And then we're just going to go through this, and wherever we had referred to the shape base class directly, we're now going to make that a T-shape. So only a couple of places in this case, but as it gets more complicated again, might have rather more of those. And then what we do in each of our derived classes, we don't just derive that from sprite, well, we can't because it's now generic. We derive it from sprite for, in this case, polyline, and we derive it, in this case, from sprite for rectangle. And that's now going to work okay, so we can still pass the polyline in there. In fact, now we have to pass a polyline in there because the base class is a sprite for polyline and the constructor takes whatever T-shape is. But the really big benefit we get from it now is, and you can see it straight away, that polyline cast is now being grayed out and we're told it's redundant because shape is now already a polyline because we've got the generic base class that we've said is for a polyline. So now I can get rid of my cast, which, as I say, isn't a huge benefit in that one case, but it makes me feel much more comfortable because shape is now the type we want. And similarly, in rectangle, we can do the same sort of thing. And in fact, you'd probably simplify this even more. We don't even now need to have the separate variable. We can just put that in there and we get the much neater one there. However, if we now try to run the tests on that, we'll see we're actually getting a build error. And the problem is now that in our annotations, we've still got this idea of a list of sprites and we don't have the sprite anymore. We have the generic sprite. So what we'd then like to do is, well, this wants to be general purpose. This isn't specific. So we want to make that a sprite generic for shape. Just get hold of the namespace and then copy that into the other places, and that now seems happy, but we still have a problem now actually in the error code. Now, although it's in the error code, this would occur in the production code as soon as we got a bit more complicated, but the problem is on those annotations, when we try to add a polyline sprite, it's rejecting it because add is expecting a shape sprite, essentially. So we've got the polyline sprite, we've got the shape sprite. And there we've got this problem of a lack of covariance, because at the moment, a polyline sprite is not a kind of sprite for shape, because we haven't done anything to suggest covariance. So the way we can introduce covariance is easy enough. We just, remember, put the keyword out on the generic parameter, but immediately we get an error there, and the error is telling us that actually you can only do that, you can only specify out or in on interfaces and delegates. You cannot do it on a class, even an abstract class. So that's not going to quite work. So what we've got to actually do is introduce an interface to make this work. So if we now go to quick actions and extract interface, we'll have everything on there. So we'll create our iSprite interface. And if we look at that, you can see that it's done the necessary work. It's put the generic in there. All we need to do is put the out keyword on that one to allow for the covariance. And we can see it works. Remember, when we had out, that basically meant we can only return the generic parameter. We can't take it as a parameter into a method. And that's all we're doing, that T shape there. So that's what we've got there. Then our sprite is going to implement that fine. The only other thing we've got to do is go back to our annotations, and rather than have the base class as sprite of shape, we have the base class as iSprite of shape. But now, because we've done that, and if we do a rebuild, just to make sure, we can see those errors have gone away. So now in here, where I'm trying to add a polyline sprite into annotations, now the covariance is working. So just like you're allowed to assign a list of apples into an IEnumerable of fruit, which is what we saw in the original examples on covariance, we can see here it's okay to pass in a polyline sprite to something that is expecting an iSprite for shape. And so if we run the tests again now, we should see that they still pass, so that's all okay. So it hasn't changed the behavior at all, but it has solved this small but potentially troubling problem whereby previously we had to do the cast because a sprite just understood shapes. It didn't really understand polylines and rectangles. Now, with a bit of generic work and an interface and an out on that generic parameter, we've made it so it makes quite practical use of covariance and gives us some more robust code. So what we've had there is a slightly more practical example of something you might need to do for yourself in your own code of covariance, rather than what we had before, where it was just showing you how the existing code worked. So hope you enjoyed that. If you did, do click like, do subscribe. I'll see you next time.